Funding for To the Contrary provided by the E. Rhodes and Leona B. Carpenter Foundation, the Colcom Foundation, and the Charles A. Frioff Foundation.
Hello, I'm Bonnie Urbay. Welcome to the Contrary, a weekly discussion of news and social trends from diverse perspectives. This week, we have the honor of interviewing the Honorable Rosie Rios, the 43rd Treasurer of the United States. Welcome.
Thank you, Bonnie. It's great to be here.
All right, terrific. Now, first of all, tell the audience, if you don't mind, the difference between being treasurer and being secretary of the treasury.
Absolutely. Well, technically, the secretary of the treasury is my boss. So the treasury of the United States was the continental treasurer until 1789, when we became officially, when George Washington became president. So that's when it became treasury of the United States. And that's when Alexander Hamilton was also appointed as the secretary of the treasury.
So you follow in very honorable footsteps.
Absolutely. And she's usually in step with the president. So interestingly enough, I was the 43rd Treasury of the United States. President Obama was the 44th president.
Oh, interesting. Now, how many female treasurers have there been?
Well, it's been a female since 1949. So there have been many.
Interesting.
Very different portfolios. There have been different levels of responsibility. The first Treasury of the United States was set up to really fund the wars at that time. And that was, again, 1777 until it became Treasury of the United States in 1789. But my portfolio was very different from any previous treasurers.
What was your portfolio?
So I made a proposal for what I wanted to oversee. And so I wanted oversight over the Bureau of Engraving and Printing, where we produce our paper currency in the US Mint, where we produce our coins. I also am the first ever to be appointed as a senior advisor to the secretary on areas of community development and public engagement. And I was also the chair of the Advanced Counterfeit Deterrence Steering Committee, which is the only formal collaborative between Treasury, Secret Service, and the Federal Reserve, specifically on counterfeiting issues and currency design.
Okay, so why did you choose those areas? Why did you?
I intentionally chose those areas because it was actually during my time on the Treasury Federal Reserve Transition Team in the fall of 2008, when this concept of redesigning our nation's currency to feature the portrait of a woman on our Federal Reserve notes for the first time in our nation's history actually came to my mind. And I needed to cobble together those responsibilities in order to make it happen.
What drew you, what made you want to specialize in getting women on treasury notes?
Dollars? Yeah, well, I call myself an accidental feminist, an accidental historian, accidental educator. And it was during that time on the transition team where I was awakened. So prior to coming on board in the fall of 2008, I was managing director of investments for a $22 billion firm based in San Francisco. And when I got the call in October of 2008, Congress had just passed the Emergency Economic Stabilization Act. They were looking for finance professionals to come in and implement that legislation so that should President Obama win in November, it would be a smooth transition. So when I got the call, I took what I had, it was my 14-week vacation. I made the jump, and it was a very stressful time, if you can imagine. It was one of the most consequential times of our economic history, working closely with the Bush administration. And very, very stressful. So I found my breaks, my respite in the Historical Resource Center at Treasury. What people wouldn't know is that Treasury didn't just produce financial products like currency. They produced everything from savings bonds to military payment certificates to postage stamps. They still produce the security page of your passport. So all those archived items, which most of which had never been seen by the public or even people living at the moment, all those concept and renderings that were used to produce these products were in the resource center. And I just loved going through it. And after a while, you kind of see this pattern. And what I saw on a lot of the images that were used, every single image of a woman that I came across was not a real woman. It was an allegorical woman, like a Lady Liberty type, you know, sometimes wearing a toga and sometimes no toga. but every single image of a man was a real man, a founding father, a president, a cabinet secretary. And then I dug a little deeper and I realized, my goodness, we've never had the portrait of a woman on our Federal Reserve notes. And when I looked around, did a little bit more homework, and I realized at that point in time, there are almost 30 countries who had women on their modern day currency. And so, you know, as the leader of the free world and kind of in the spirit of democracy, when you look at currency, you know, currency is a way to institutionalize our history, right? So it's usually a very important person on the front, a very symbolic edifice or monument on the back. Well, if this is the way we're supposed to preserve our history, how could we be missing 51% of our population? And again, especially as the leader of the free world. So the concept came to me, and what was interesting, I think, is when I asked the Bureau of Engraving and Printing director and his deputy separately why this has never happened, they all gave me the same answer, which is no one's ever brought it up. And, you know, could it be that
even
simple?
Even though there had been women treasurers since...
Well, let's make this very clear. This isn't because of a female treasurer. It's the Secretary of the Treasury, who has always been a male. By law, it's the Secretary of the Treasury who has the final decision on currency design. Not the president, not Congress. And it's always been a male secretary up until Janet Yellen. And so it's not really because I'm a female treasurer or the treasurer's been a treasurer since a female since 1949. It's this bigger picture, right? This consciousness that doesn't exist in our country when it comes to honoring historical American women. And I thought it was a huge issue, and I wanted it to kind of start a global conversation on why this was the case, why it was something that was simply overlooked.
You know, it parallels, we American women usually, or I was raised to think that we were ahead of the world in terms of women's rights. But when you think, it's interesting about women on the treasury notes and on coins. I want to talk about coins in a minute. But also, there are 30 or more countries that have had female leaders already. So we are way, way behind in that department too.
I agree. And it all, obviously for me, that was my kind of, again, my starting point of this journey that I've been taking about the physical recognition of historical American women. Because I do think that there's a correlation between visibility and value. And so this, you know, it's this very simple question. We value what we see every day, but do we see what we value? And it's not just currency. It's, you know, it's statues, it's congressional gold medals. It's, you know, I can go on forever on a number of the initiatives that I'm working on, and you know, your educational initiatives and classrooms, et cetera. And you know, it's the same story. It's the same story over and over and over again about this 51% that's missing in the public domain. And so how do we change that? And so that's what I've been doing in my personal time. My personal passion is trying to change the narrative.
Why Tubman? Why Harriet Tubman on the $20 bill? Because there have been more prominent women, I think, in American history, such as Shirley Chisholm, for example, the first woman to run for president, although she didn't get very far, but because the system was stacked against her. But why Tubman?
Yeah, so let me make something very, very clear again. The final decision on currency design is up to the Secretary of the Treasury. During our administration in June of 2015, we launched a public engagement effort for the first time ever to elicit feedback on who should be considered for our currency. And quite frankly, I didn't want it to be about one woman or 10 women, but the hundreds of women who've been really overlooked in our history. And so I decided at that time, it was almost a year that I was out there talking to thousands of people across the country, that I realized kind of three things. One was there was a lot of frustration out in Main Street. Two, how little the American public knew about American history. And three, how much less they knew about women in American history. And something else happened during that time. It was actually August of 2015. I received an email from my high school history teacher, who at the time was still teaching at my high school, you know, 35 years later. He saw my interview about the currency redesign process. He wanted to congratulate me, but he also wanted to thank me. He said that day in August of 2015, he walked into the classroom, which was the first day of the school year. And after, you know, at that time, after almost over 30 years of teaching American history, he realized when he walked in that morning that he never had the image of a woman on his classroom walls. He never thought about it. Salt of the earth, by the way. He said he wanted to change it, and he invited me back that fall. And I walked into that same classroom, and on the classroom walls were Susan B. Anthony, Harriet Tubman, and me. And again, that was kind of another light bulb for me, right? Can you imagine what that does for our kids when you normalize what we see every day and who is part of that narrative? And so with him, Mr. Wilder, by the way, who just retired, I decided to launch my first educational initiative called Teachers Writing History, or IGHT, which is basically I took that database that we aggregated of almost 300 historical American women from this public engagement process. And I made sure when we made the announcement of Harriet Tubman on the 20 in April of 2016, that same database was posted on our Treasury website, so it became a public document. And that database became the basis of Teachers Writing History that we launched on August 26, 2016 with my high school. Again, this is not about one woman. This is about the bigger conversation about what we value and whom we value and how we can use our past to inspire our future.
You went to Harvard. In fact, you were the first woman to have your portrait placed on a wall.
I was the first Latina in Harvard's 385-year history to have a portrait commissioned in my honor.
And because you had become treasurer.
Right? I'm assuming that and a number of other initiatives that I started at Harvard that still continue to this day.
Talk about them, please.
As a junior, actually it took me a couple of years, but as a junior at Harvard as an undergrad, I started an event called Cultural Rhythms, which is intended to be a celebration of diversity and actually what I call culture. Culture is basically the threads of the fabric of your community that includes everything, whether it be race, whether it be orientation, whether it be religion, et cetera. And I found, you know, when I started Harvard in 1983, there are very few of us who look like me. That was just the case. And so I ended up being the director of a Mexican folk dancing group on campus, one of the few in the East Coast. And there were very few opportunities to kind of celebrate this. And so I started this kind of two-day event of a food and entertainment festival to kind of highlight what we have in common. And it went on for decades.
Your signature has been on bills totaling more than $1 trillion. Do you get
1.7 trillion to be exact? Yes.
1.7 trillion. Do you get any feedback from the public about that?
I think there's kind of the personal angle and then there's kind of the public angle. So, you know, again, the fact that the treasurer has been a woman since 1949, so it has been appearing on our currency regularly, which is great. For me personally, you know, my husband's last name is Gumataotao, which is from Guam, and it's also my children's last name. And I wanted to make sure that our currency kind of reflected the diverse kind of backgrounds of my family. And I think for the public's perspective, you know, yes, I think it does mean something to see representation on something that's used every day. And if that's the way that women are represented on our currency, you know, again, that's kind of a step, but I think there are much bigger steps that should be taken again, so that we're not a novelty, we're the norm.
Okay, tell me what those steps are. And also when you're done with that, were you disappointed about the Trump administration putting up obstacles to getting what the Obama administration had set up?
So just to set the record straight, the $10 note is the next note to be redesigned. It was always the next note to be redesigned. So as chair of the Advanced Counterfeit Deterrence Steering Committee, we monitored counterfeiting threats. And it's usually measured by parts per million. And the $10 note during my tenure has always had the highest percentage of counterfeiting threat. And that remains the same today. The time frame that was set out when I left the administration on the sequencing of the notes, with the $10 note being first, then the 20, the timing of those notes has changed a little bit. My understanding is that, you know, it could very well be that the $50 note is going to come before the $20 note. And, you know, that being said, obviously, you know, that, again, that's based on counterfeiting threats. So, you know, it's up to this administration, and specifically, you know, Secretary of the Treasury Janet Yellen, on what those next steps look like. And that is within her purview.
Who else do you think should be on dollars, on currency, paper currency, paper money?
You mean, there are other women who I'd like to see on currency personally? Sure, I'd love to see my mom on currency. But the specific law as it relates to portraits on currency is that you obviously need to be American, but you have to be deceased. That is a law. And that actually came with when Secretary Salmon Chase actually put himself on the $10,000 bill when he was still alive. So that changed with Congress. But other than that, I would love to see my mom on the $10 bill. I would love that.
Aside from your mom, I'm talking historical figures.
Well, in addition to Harriet Tubman, which I think was a fine recommendation, you know, I would, coming off of kind of 2020 and the suffrage centennial, I would have loved to have seen also some suffrage activists, Susan B. Anthony, just because I think she has been a symbolic representation of the 19th Amendment. I think that would have been a great choice for the $10 bill. You know, certainly, again, if you look at our database on teachers writing history, RIGHT, you will see, again, hundreds of folks to learn about. Again, it's not just one or two. Really, we have a lot of work to do when it comes to the history of our country.
Well, tell me about some of the more interesting ones, please.
Well, I learned someone I didn't even realize existed until this process was Grace Hopper. I mean, here, you know, she was an admiral in the Navy. She's the one who developed what became the software for COBOL. You know, and she was definitely, you know, raised during a time where she had to kind of struggle to find her place. And I think for here, you know, I'm from the Bay Area, from Silicon Valley, and I think she represents for many people here in the Bay Area and Silicon Valley, kind of a pioneer, if you will, of technology. You know, other women who have inspired me, you know, well, and it's interesting because I think if, you know, this wasn't intended to be a vote. It wasn't, you know, I think people kind of took this public engagement process as, you know, we vote for this person versus that person. You know, this wasn't a pageant. This was, you know, in fact, if it was based on counts, my goodness, those Girl Scouts are so organized. The founder of the Girl Scouts would have been a great choice, again, if it was just based on vote counts, but that wasn't the point. The point was, how do you start this conversation about 51% of the population? And why I think it's so important to think about 51% of the population is because it's an equity issue. Right? We all have skin in this game. If you have a mother, a sister, a daughter, a niece, et cetera, you know, I do think that if we feel marginalized, whether it's in the classroom, whether it is in what you see every day around you, I think it does have an impact on your confidence and in reaching your full potential.
Now, tell us what you did about coin currency.
Going back about 5 years, proposed legislation that would honor historical American women on our quarters, the quarters in your pocket. And kind of ironically, if you can believe this, I mentioned already that currency design is decided by one person, the Secretary of the Treasury, by law. Coin design is literally an act of Congress. Congress decides the designs of our coins. And again, the purpose of the legislation was, you know, kind of in tandem as this other effort with paper currency and all the other initiatives that I was working on, but can we start seeing something that, especially for kids, to kind of collect? Because if you think about it, what do kids collect these days, right? In my day, it was stamps or coins, et cetera, you know, playing cards. These days, you know, kids collect likes or, you know, followers, et cetera. And the thought of kind of, you know, buried treasure, kind of looking for these coins as they come out, I thought would be really kind of a fun way to learn about history. So lo and behold, and thankfully to the great work of Congresswoman Barbara Lee here from the Bay Area, who partnered with me to move this forward, we had a lot of fits and starts where it passed in the House and it didn't pass in the Senate, et cetera. But finally, yes, this legislation, which also includes, by the way, youth sports, It also will honor the Olympics. It will also honor the Special Olympics and our nation's 250th anniversary in 2026. This legislation finally passed in December and was signed by the president in January. So starting next year in 2022, you will see quarters. The first ones include Maya Angelou, for example, Sally Ride, quarters with these designs that you can now literally collect, use, own, and value more than anything.
But there already is a Susan B. Anthony dollar coin, no?
There are Susan B. Anthony dollar coins out there. Absolutely, that was from the 80s. You know, unfortunately, the size of that coin, they weren't, because it was kind of close to the quarter size. It wasn't used, I think, as much as people would have wanted to see, and especially dollar coins in general aren't really used. But people still use quarters, believe it or not, in droves, very much still in high demand. So the fact that people can actually, again, use something and see something every day that represents them is very, very important.
Now, do you believe that this will, that putting women on the dollar bills and on coins will motivate a lot more females to get into finance?
I think anything that highlights the role that women play, period, will motivate everyone, boys and girls, men and women, to think about each other differently. Now, will that translate into more women getting in finance? Look, I think there is definitely, as I mentioned, a correlation between visibility and value, but I also think that there's something that needs to happen when it comes to women in positions of money and power. So if you think about it this way, you know, the pillars of influence, sex, money, and power. And unfortunately, kind of women have been kind of relegated to that, you know, sandbox of kind of their physical self. And women have not had a chance to participate in decisions of money and power. If you look at the kind of the political, social, and economic indicators of where women are, whether it's women, you know, female governors, women in the C-suite, women in boardrooms, women in Congress, senators, we all, the numbers are strange. We tend to flatline around 20%, and we can't get past it. And it's been like that forever. And moving that needle is so difficult. And if you think about it that way, I mean, first of all, nothing happens at 20%, nothing. And if men are in 80% of those senior executive decision capacities, they absolutely have to be part of the solution. And I got to tell you, in a lot of my initiatives, most of my champions have been men with daughters. And I do think that people realize that it is going to be their daughter who's going to be impacted or held back or have that, what I call a confidence deficit. Again, where they won't be able to reach their full potential if we don't value 51% of our community. There are definite impacts. And I want to remind people that in 2026, is the 250th anniversary of our nation's founding. And again, maybe that's even up to interpretation, how you want to define that. But I was appointed to the executive committee of this congressional commission called America 250 that is planning the commemoration activities. And so I kind of think about this summer, July 4th, as kind of the 5-year count up, right? So here I started this journey in 2008. My journey continues with all my other educational initiatives. But it's also kind of a way to really think about these next 5 years. How do we want our history to be reflected? What are those conversations that we still need to have so that we are that more perfect union that we all aspire to be? And so I kind of throw the gauntlet down. July 4th of 2021 is that 5-year count up to have not just this domestic, but this global conversation of who we want to be and how we want to be represented.
You've been pushing so hard and for so many years to get women on paper currency and on coins. And now the world seems to be switching to cryptocurrency. So what do you want to see done for women in that arena?
That's a great question. So first of all, you know, currency and coin demand isn't going to go away anytime soon. In fact, when I started out, I think it was $835 billion of currency in circulation. Today, it's over $2 trillion, and that will continue. Again, optionality is key. And certainly crypto is part of that space, as it should be. I mean, I think it's any options that provide these pathways to people who were traditionally left out of the banking system, I think, is great for everyone. You know, when it comes to women, you know, look, I am now co-host of this reality series called Unicorn Hunters. And it's a way to provide access to capital for both pre-IPO founders who are looking to raise money, but also for Main Street investors who would traditionally be locked out of the pre-IPO investment opportunity. And my number one goal is to make sure that we find more female founders. You know, if you think about, and the great part about the show, you know, it actually started with this Access to Capital conference that we had in 2011 in Treasury that led to the formation of this task force that ultimately made the recommendations for the Jobs Act of 2012, the Jumpstart a Business Startups Act, which, you know, included these crowdfunding provisions. So that access to capital is key. It's all about jobs in this next economic recovery. And anything that I can do to promote female founders and open those doors of opportunity, I think is great for everyone.
All right, and thank you for pointing to the future. That's a good note to end on. Please continue the conversation with us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And whether you agree or think to the contrary, please join us next time.
Funding for To the Contrary provided by the E. Rhodes and Leona B. Carpenter Foundation, the Colcom Foundation, and the Charles A. Freehoff Foundation. For a transcript or to see an online version of this episode of To the Contrary, please visit our PBS website at pbs.org/To the Contrary.